the D by D podcast on this April 9th, 2017.
Yeah.
And the Saints are just hyping shit up for everybody. Can you imagine you get one news article that says that Richard Sherman is the Saints of front runners.
The Predator.
To get the Predator. Okay, and then you read the next article right next to it, and it says Malcolm Butler will be a Saint at some time. Cook. Right. So is this going to be? Is it one or the other? Is it both? Are you going to have a Richard Sherman, Malcolm Butler combo,
and a Mark Ingram, and no Adrian money? Peterson combo?
Yeah, and no money left after. How do you get that money to pay for these guys? Because I think Richard Sherman's going to be looking for some ends. Oh, is it a trade? Is that a trade?
It would be a trade, but I'm not sure how long his contract has left. He's going to want to get paid eventually.
Yep. And then you got Malcolm Butler, who is going to be a trade, who's going to be looking to get paid eventually. And then you got Adrian Peterson that isn't going to get the value that he wanted a week ago, but he's still going to get some money.
Adrian Peterson's most famous game was in the Superdome.
Yeah,
fumbled, NFC Championship
fumbled,
game.
What, man. Three times?
Two or three times.
He always wanted to be a Saint.
Everybody throws it on Brett Favre.
He was rooting for the Saints the whole time.
Adrian Peterson had a rough night that night, too. I was there, me and 2 million other people.
I wasn't, but it was the greatest. It was better than the Super Bowl. I can tell you that.
It was fourth.
Super Bowl was great, too, but like just the moment of getting there, I think, I don't know, it's almost like if you knew once they made it, they're going to win. Like, there's no way they're losing the Super Bowl. It's not happening.
They were 7-point dogs, man.
I know, but it's not happening because they've never won before. They've never been there.
That Colts team was pretty good.
Yeah, they were scary. Their offense was ridiculous.
I would say that Colts team was better than the Colts team that won the Super Bowl.
It was. Definitely was. I mean, Chicago had no offensive at all. Like, they would have lost that game.
If you remember
Chicago
that year,
had any kind of offense.
The Colts had a dramatic game to get in the Super Bowl. They had came back and beat New England.
24-3 or something they were losing. Yeah, and you didn't think that was going to happen. But they came back and won. That was probably Peyton Manning's biggest win of all time, was coming back to beat Tom Brady, losing 24-3.
What's up?
Similar to laying the Falcons who laid the egg.
Well, since the last time you heard from us, people, the Pelicans are officially eliminated from playoff contention. How you feel about that?
I don't give a fuck.
I don't give a fuck. And they right now have a 4% chance of landing a top 3 draft pick, which in turn could get them a good player, which they won't get. So Sacramento will have like the 10th pick of the draft.
So where are they going to pick again? I'm sorry, I lost. The third pick, you said?
No, they have a 4% chance of getting a third pick. The only way they keep their draft pick is if it's in the top 3. If it isn't in the top 3, Sacramento gets it.
That's not going to happen.
But the good thing about that is the pick won't be 4, 5, 6. The only way the Pelicans can move up is if it's in the top 3. If they don't get in the top 3, they stuck wherever they are in the standard. So right now they'd be like the 10th or 11th pick.
Yeah, so they'll get another nobody.
Well, Sacramento will get a nobody.
Well, you know, next year there's going to be, it's put up a shut up for sure for them.
Shout out to Tim Tebow, man. Hit a home run, his first minor league at bat.
Yep. You ever see, watching that dude swing a bat, it's like he's got so much like upper body strength that his arms don't even look like they get all the way. Like, the bat don't come all the way around, bro. Like, he can't get it.
Yeah, I've never seen him swing.
Yeah, well, I mean, I watched him swing during the, when he was trying out, you know, and they had, like, every news media outlet in the
country. Oh,
the
ESPN, yeah, out there watching.
Just to go watch him try out for some minor league baseball team.
The Cubbies are 3-2 playing right now. They're winning by 4, top of the ninth. Big season. 18 days, I'll be in Boston watching the Cubs play the Red Sox. Shout out to Poncho, Mike.
I don't care.
Shout out to my boy Don. Your coworker.
Yeah. I don't care about the Cubs.
Oh, you need to care because you're going to have to find a co-host that weekend.
Oh, I will. I'm getting it in. I'm going to have a nice... Don't worry, people. We're going to record one. It will happen. And then when he gets back to town, he's going to
I'll be fine.
Yeah. He's going to have to set it up for me.
Yep.
So
it'll be on YouTube. We're on YouTube now, thanks to Higgnz.
We on YouTube. We got everything set up. We have a YouTube channel. And more. There's more to come.
We have the website up, too.
All the old music that we can put on there is actually going to be put on the channel. So y'all be able to access all of it from YouTube. And it one step at a time. We got a website is coming. The blogs are coming. It's all going to come. And the website, we should be able to access everything through the website itself.
Hopefully the shows will be coming pretty soon.
Yeah, well, we got to finish the record. And we're in the current mixdown mode of the Soul Tribe record.
Yeah, the studio is deployed for the next few weeks. So.
Yep. So it's going to be nice. We actually got first thing we finished in 5 years, 5.5 years, something like that.
Yeah.
Almost six, you know. But, hey, look, it's okay. You know how many artists actually take a break like that before and come back and do what they do? I mean, hey, it is what it is. But I'm excited about it. You only live once, bro. So you got to take advantage of your opportunity while you're here on this planet.
Like Steven Tyler said, bro, something going on in the world today, bro. So what's going on?
There's always something going on. But I don't
Shout out to Tupac, latest Rock and Roll Hall of Famer.
Yeah. Yeah, where was the Outlaws at, bro?
I know, we talked about this. So.
Like, I didn't see the video. I watched a clip that somebody filmed when they were out in the crowd. So I didn't actually get to see the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame ceremony itself in HD fashion. You know, I'm sure I can go check it out if I go look far enough to find it. But I didn't really think that justice was really served for his ceremony. I mean, like I told you, dude, they didn't even have a podium for the man, bro.
I know. I've seen that.
They just threw a mic stand out there and brought Snoop out there to talk on a mic stand through a teleprompter. And it just wasn't, you know, I read his speech, and he had a good speech. Like, what he had to say was nice. Like, it was a good speech. But I thought there was more people that were close to him that should have been involved in that situation that didn't get a chance to actually hold it down. Like, Snoop accepted the award and did the speech. Where were the Outlaws at once again? That was his that's his fan. That's his people. That's the people who, you know, like, that should have been his music beneficiaries outside of his mother. Like, that was his crew, you know?
I wonder if any of the Outlaws actually shared that on Twitter. If
they actually no had a idea. Problem. You'd have to go on Twitter tweet and see for Twitter yourself.
Tweet. You I'm know? Actually looking at the list of Rock and Roll Hall of Famers because I see this a lot when they said that Tupac was getting in the Hall of Fame. That, it's Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. What kind of rock music did Tupac do? So my answer to them was Beastie Boys in the Hall of Fame, Run DMC's in the Hall of Fame, and Public Enemy's in the Hall of Fame. So I'm going through a list now of all the people that you wouldn't actually call rock music in the Hall of Fame. Grandmaster Flash is in the Hall of Fame. I didn't know that. Did you know that?
Who?
Grandmaster Flash in the Furious Five.
Oh, they should be.
I mean, pretty much started hip-hop.
I think he was the first one.
Dr. John's in the Hall of Fame. Did you know that? Shout out to Dr. John.
Dr. John deserves to be in there too.
Would you consider his music rock and roll?
His music rock and roll?
Yeah.
Not really. I guess. I mean, is that era that he was doing what he does.
Looking at this list really, though of people that's in the Hall of Fame.
I guess that was rock and roll at that time.
Yeah, looking at this list of people that's in the Hall of Fame.
It's not just about rock and roll. It's just something that they named it.
I understand you saying that, but just by looking at the list of inductees alone, and I'm kind of changing my tune now as we talk about this, I don't really see many jazz musicians, country musicians, or anything like that in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. I see a few blues artists like B.B. King, but I could kind of see where people would have that issue. Prince is in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. He pretty much rocked, though. Some of his stuff was rock. I could kind of see people's gripe in that.
Why?
Just because of the fact of just the artists that are in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And I'm a big Tupac fan, but I could see why people would say, why would you put him in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame? Parliament's in the
Rock there is no other Hall of Fame.
They have a hip-hop Hall of Fame.
It's a music Hall of Fame.
They have a hip-hop
Hall
of Fame.
Well, I'm sure he's been in there already. Yeah. The hip-hop Hall of Fame, I don't know anything about it. And should I be ashamed of myself? I'm sure there's many hip-hop artists that have no idea that they even exist. But
I would say Pac, if they had like an entertainer Hall of Fame.
The Rock and Roll Hall of Fame is the music Hall of Fame. End of story. It is what it's the music Hall of Fame. And any other artist from any other genre of music that you feel that isn't in there at this point in time is basically your opinion. I can't justify why this person is or isn't in the Hall of Fame. I just know that Tupac made it in the Hall of Fame. That NWA's in the Hall of Fame.
Right.
Beastie Boys is in the Hall of Fame. Run DMC's in the Hall of Fame. Grandmaster Flash is in the Hall of Fame. That's what I do know for sure. And I feel like they all deserve it.
So shouldn't jazz musicians and country musicians get the same benefit?
Yes, absolutely. I think Garth Brooks should be. Is he in the Hall of Fame?
No country. I scrolled through it quick, but I didn't know country musician like George Jones or Hank Williams. Nothing like that.
Should be George Strait. Hall of Famer.
Nothing like that popped up.
Alan Jackson should be a Hall of Famer.
Right. No jazz musicians popped up.
B.B. King's not in the Hall of Fame?
Well, he's a blues musician, so.
But still.
He's in there. He's in there.
Almost in that same.
Blues is in there.
Right in that same category. They right next to each other. They brother and sister.
Oh, I think they're more like second cousins.
Nah. I don't know. They close. Blues and jazz are right, you know.
I agreed with you until about 2 minutes ago.
What would you disagree about?
Just the fact, not the fact that he got in.
You don't think he should be in there?
No. Not the fact that he got in.
There's nothing to disagree about.
But the criteria, judging by past inductees.
That's not my fault.
It's not. You weren't there.
Nope. But no, I get it. I understand. Like, do you think they should be in the Hall of Fame?
I do.
But then we're not really disagreeing.
If there is a music Hall of Fame, they should be in it because they change actual culture of music. There's no R&B artists on there, really.
I know. Jodeci should be in the Hall of Fame. We can go. That's a whole long list of artists.
Jodeci should be in the Hall of Fame. Yeah. There's a lot more R&B artists that should be in before Jodeci, bro.
Bobby Brown?
Bobby Brown should be in before Jodeci.
Yeah, I don't know.
Whitney Houston should be in the Hall of Fame. Yeah. I didn't see her name on that list.
Yeah, we can go on. Like,
I mean, she might be on it. I was just scrolling through.
So you telling me that, all right, so you saying that rock artists made it to the Hall of Fame, and then all of a sudden they skip clean over every genre of music and jump right into rap music?
No, I'm looking again. They have a few R&B artists like Earth, Wind & Fire is in the Hall of Fame, but you could even consider them with live music.
So what about some disco, bro? What about the Bee Gees?
Oh man, you're gonna have to have me looking.
Dude,
Guns N' Roses is in the Hall of Fame. I would question that. I mean, I guess
Guns N' Roses. Why? 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 Tell me. I don't understand.
I like Guns N' Roses. I guess they would be in the Hall of Fame. They sold a shitload of records. Pearl Jam made it this year, dude.
Pearl Jam, yeah. Oh, they made it with Pop.
They made it this year. Journey and Pearl
Jam.
So,
if you saying
that... How it took this long for Journey to get in the Hall of Fame?
That I find hard to believe. When they got in? This year?
This year. So if you had to pick Journey or Guns N' Roses, who should be in the Hall of Fame first?
To me, all right, Journey just made it. There's some politics behind that because Run DMC... like I just said, Run DMC, Beastie Boys, they all made it in the Hall of Fame before Journey made it in the Hall of Fame. Journey probably sold 1 billion records, bro. Like, billion records, dude. I don't see how they didn't make it.
Donna Summer made the Hall of Fame. Darn
it. You know, it's got to be, like I said, there's got to be some politics behind it. Because when NWA made it in, the movie was coming out. Tupac just made it in. The movie's coming out. So they wanted to make sure, like, in the way they induct these cats, the Hall of Fame is always this time of year. So the movie, the Pac movie, been done, been finished. It was supposed to come out. Remember they set a release date, and then they swiped the release date?
They're putting it out on his birthday now.
Right. But was it really because they wanted to put it out on his birthday, or they wanted to put it out at the right time, and his birthday just happened to fall in that right, in that
it
that
could
time
be
because the... let's induct him in the Hall of Fame and then put the movie out, just like they did with NWA.
So speaking of the Pac movie, the new trailer came out. What you think, man?
Sweet. Did ready you, to go see it, bro.
I wonder if they're making a remix to All Eyes on Me with that beat.
Be
you heard that beat?
Up like
that,
the like them dudes line up to go see Star Wars when it comes out, bro.
Man, we talked about this last year before there was a podcast. Or 2 years ago when the NWA movie was coming out. Like, how many young cats are going to go to the show and try to emulate Pac, come out with that black leather vest? And
you seen that? You didn't see that?
No.
I came out with the leather vest, and nobody can rock that vest with Pac.
I don't want to try.
No, it's a very unique outfit.
What about the pictures in the bathtub when he's got all the gold around him? He's in a you remember that? I think it was a Rolling Stone
like
or a Vibe picture.
Yeah, butt naked and he put the gold on him. You think he had a G-string on today, bro? You want to think about that?
Nah, I'm good.
No. So, like, that's something that I guess only Pac could do, bro. Nobody could do that.
But that's crazy. I was listening to an Ice-T interview yesterday about, you know, just his stories about Pac. And I like to hear stories about guys who just didn't worship Pac.
Yeah, like, they just sell him to the camera, basically.
Yeah. So I wish he had more people like Ice-T around when he was alive. Maybe he wouldn't have... But Ice-T broke it down good. I don't know if you got that far into it. I don't know how long your video went. But he said the people that wasn't raised around gangs in L.A., that come in to L.A., and all of a sudden the gangs accept them and stuff like that, they kind of lose touch.
They
you know?
Jump into the gang life, you know. I guess it's similar to Common's song when he talked about hip-hop. How like it moved when hip hop moved to the West Coast and she dived right into the gangs. Similar thing, I guess. Same,
yeah.
You know, you fall right into it, into the trap. But the one story that stuck out to me in that was when he said that, you know, he said Pac always looked for his advice. Like Pac would come to him. He respected him. He was the OG, you know, on the West Coast. You know what I mean? Like what? So he would come to him and give him look for advice and look up to his opinion, and he played Hit Him Up for him, and I guess he was looking for a different result.
He wanted props.
Yeah, and Ice-T pretty much told him you can't do that, bro. Like
you he think, shot you got you think he shot you? Why you gonna retaliate on a song?
Right. And you think that's how you handle it? You're gonna retaliate on a song, and there's two sides to look at that. For one, Ice-T's point, you're right. The dude's 25. He's not thinking with his, you know, he's not thinking right. You know, he's 25. He's caught up in what's going on. Like he's right. You could really look at where he was at that time, and he was deep. Like he was really caught up in the cloud of smoke, and he couldn't see outside that box that he was that room of smoke that was filled up around him. And he had people that was influencing him to do stuff like that. You know, like you said, the guy claims he shot him. He's, you know, like, this dude he got you shot, and that's how you handle it. Not saying that you're going to go out there and kill him, but that's how you're going to handle it. But you can also make a point that if you think he did that, well, the best way to get at him is to get at his money. And if I could sabotage his career, and then I sabotage his paycheck, then I sabotage his life that way.
Yeah, because really, you're too famous to go out and just shoot somebody.
Well, right? Yeah, but you can also, if obviously, Biggie supposedly, like you say, he accused Biggie of getting him hit. I mean, you can always get him hit. This story saying that Puffy is the one who got Pac hit.
What about this other story that it was Suge's ex-wife's?
That's people crazy. That, she came on video. They have a video with her coming out saying that that would be stupid. Why would I do that? Like, Pac was Big Death Row's money. I was collecting those checks. I was spending that money. Why, you know, why would I go kill, like, just destroy the money?
You think Suge's just nervous about the movie and how they're going to portray him? Because they may portray Suge Knight having something to do with the movie.
I don't know how they're going to push that. I think, I don't know, but here's my guess. If I had to guess, I think they're going to still leave it. They're going to make everybody think that, have their own opinion based on what they saw. You know, it, the mystery is going to be to the forefront. Like, you could have thought that Pac did it. Get, you know, like that Suge set Pac up. You're going to think that Orlando Anderson did it. You're going to think that Puffy did it, you know, because of what was everything that was circulating at that point in time.
Yeah, one thing I hope the movie does, though, is I hope they show the different sides of him. I hope they don't just kiss his ass and he had issues, right?
I think that's what's, it's the untold story. So
yeah, so I
think they are going to try to not, they're not going to, because, dude, I mean, come on, real talk. Like, the dude did some things that wasn't, you know, that wasn't right. He, no doubt. I loved him. I loved him for who he was.
But
he did some things that was just outlandish. Like, you know, you need to stop and think about what you're
doing.
I like
the NWA movie, but they kind of portrayed them dudes as kind of like no do wrongs, you know?
Yeah, well,
I mean, they not totally, but I mean, they, well, you only seen one side of them.
Yeah, it was their side. That was their side of the story. You also got five people that you're trying to tell a story about. Five artists that you're trying to tell a story about.
Right.
And you can't really
deal with it. Like, for Dre's instance, you didn't have the issue with him and the lady reporter. Her name escapes my mind now.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, there was so much stuff that was left out. And that's why Michelle made her own movie about him. Because she's like, I didn't even get mentioned in this movie, you know, at all. And I was right there the whole time. I was married to this dude. Like, they never even talked about his personal life. And he was, the fact that he was married the whole time. And then she turned around and married Suge Knight. Like, and even then, like, I remember when Death Row was big and you didn't even know none of that was going. Like, I remember hearing that Dre and Michelle A were married, but that wasn't to, like, their personal lives never hit the forefront even at that time.
Well, you didn't have social media and nobody wanted to be hip hop housewives.
Yeah, I guess you had to really read into that to find out about that kind of stuff.
Yeah, you dig in the magazines.
But for, you know, just when you look at it now, like, the fact that the story tells that she went from Dre. And when Dre left, she got with Suge. And supposedly Suge, she says that the whole reason why Suge Knight got with her was because he was just trying to, like, destroy Dre. And she bought into it because of the fact that she had security. You know, like, she felt safe around him. So that's why she did it. So, but that's a whole nother side of the story. Like, we digging into shit that...
Well, sticking to music, man. Ryan, I sent you this earlier this week. DMX tweeted he was looking for trap beats.
Wanted
to record some new music. He wanted to start trapping.
So what? Like, if the dude wants to spit a trap... He didn't say, I'm making a trap album. He just wants to look at some trap beats.
Oh, dog. What are they doing?
But he might want to do like one song on his whole album. He wants to, and even it might not even make the album.
Well, they said the internet was just killing him about being an old head and you trying to be relevant again, and he ended up deleting a tweet after that.
Right? There's no telling what he would have. You don't know what he would have did to that beat. And who's is like nobody knows. I think that's just silly. I get people. You're on Twitter tweeting that, so. I guess when you go on social media and you say whatever you want to say, you're opening yourself up to get any kind of backlash that comes with it. Like, he might have did that. Dude, he might have been just chilling, bro. Watch this. Watch what I'm about to do.
Yeah.
And fucking sitting next to Swiss, bro, and they just chilling or something. Whatever. I'm just trying to paint a story here for you. Why I'm about to fuck everybody.
Hold my beer. Up.
Yeah, right? You know, and he tweeted that just so they can get a laugh out of it and get some attention. That's all it takes. So I think that's just need to let that man chill and wait till a record comes out before you judge. You know, it might be something that he does. He might want to put one song on his album.
How many records you made it through DMX before you kind of cut him off?
Really after the third one?
The fourth one's pretty good though. The fourth one I got when I was in boot camp. When I got out of boot camp, I was in tech school. Well, basic training. I went to tech school for the Air Force and I bought the fourth record and I didn't like, you know, I didn't like it, but it just wasn't like the other ones. But it actually grew on me. If you actually went back, it's got a lot of replay.
Well, and that's what I hope. Like, I'd have to go back and listen to a lot of it. Like, every album he did, there's always one or two songs that are, like, timeless, bro. That's how I feel. Like, there's always at least one or two songs on every album he did that are really good and speak from the heart and the deep and the timeless. Like, you could take that and it could get you through the day. And that's the best music out there. But...
Dude filled that Pac void after Pac died.
Well, he did. I mean,
better than a lot of, you know, everybody was trying.
Yeah.
Almost every rapper on No Limit tried.
Yeah. And he had but he came with his own style, though. You know? Like, he was still his own person.
But he was deep. Like right. He was deep. That's nobody else had.
Nobody had that passion. And that's what people think. Like, oh, you know, a lot of people look, oh, he's the new Pac. No, he's the first X. You know what I'm saying? Like, just because he's deep doesn't mean that he's trying to emulate any other artist. He's being himself. That's who he was. They say that's who he was before, after. When you talk to him, when you listen to him in an interview, bro.
My favorite X record is Flesh of My Flesh, Blood of My Blood.
That's your favorite?
It's still one of my top five albums I've ever had.
Yeah, it's good. It was a good one. It was better than the first one. Like, the second one, he brushed up.
Most people say the third one. They like the third one, but I like the second one.
I don't know. I'm different. Like,
the third one's real pop. I don't want to say popish, but it's
he,
very commercial.
He had more money to spend, probably. Yeah, it was probably it's very a bigger commercial. Budget on that. Through so Cisco he was able on to there. Bring in the features. Yeah, Cisco was the hottest thing in R&B at the time.
Should he be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame?
No.
Drew Hill? No.
No.
Drew Hill or Jodeci? Which one are you going with first?
Jodeci, no doubt, bro. Jodeci was the best R&B group in the 90s.
Better than 112?
Yes.
Better than
112 wanted to be Jodeci. Jodeci set their own.
What about Jagged Edge, bro?
Jagged Edge was all right. Jagged Edge got what they got. Because if there would be no Jagged Edge without Jodeci, bro.
That's fucking dude. There'd be no Jodeci without New Edition.
Possibly. But what about Boys the Men? They should be in the Rock and Roll.
Man, we
Hall
did this all year already. Man. Did this all. What? Who should be in there first? You told me a couple of podcasts ago that Jodeci was better than Boys the Men.
Yeah, but I'm just saying Boys the Men should be.
Boys the Men sold a shit more.
That's an
more
opinion.
Yeah.
That's my opinion. That's not solid proof. Boys the Men was the biggest thing in R&B, probably. Ever because they sold the most.
Janet Jackson's not in the Hall of Fame.
Yeah, but Janet, I don't know.
I mean, we're going R&B here.
Michael, bro. Did Michael make it?
Michael's in there.
He should have made it. He should have made it after Thriller, bro. Fuck.
You a thriller guy or you an off the wall guy?
Off the wall, that's the second one, right? Which one?
No, off the wall.
Off the wall is the old one. The old one. I'm sorry.
Wanna be starting something? Pretty young thing. No, pretty young thing might be on thriller.
Yeah, he was still in that kind of that was that late 70s, early 80s sound. I don't know. That Thriller album's legit. That Thriller album for would Beat It.
It's pretty Billie young thing. Jean? On Pretty Young Thing might have been on
Billie
Thriller.
Jean's on Off the Wall. Billie Jean's on
Billie
Thriller.
Jean's on Thriller. But I'm trying to remember where Pretty Young Thing was.
Dirty Diana is the shit, bro.
I think that's after. That might be after Thriller.
That was like I'm bad. Yeah.
What about LL? LL should be in the Hall of LL or Tupac. Wait. Who should be in the Hall of Fame first, LL or Tupac?
I mean, I guess you'd have to go LL in that regard. But the way they setting this thing up, it really doesn't matter about your catalog. It's about what you did.
Rick Rubin should be in the Hall of Fame before a lot of these cats.
Rick Rubin was a huge.
He was a huge influence on rock and rap.
But he's not really rap. He wasn't a performer. Yeah, he wasn't a vocalist. But. And that's where producers or the band of an MC, bro. So they should get the same long, like all these big producers like Swizz Beatz should get the same respect that the artist should get, that the vocalist should get. Because that's all a rapper is a vocalist. He can't do it.
The producer's his band.
Right. So Eminem's going to be in the whole Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Like, no doubt. He produced his own. He produced a lot of his records. So, you know, he should make it as a producer artist/artist. Not just a vocalist. I'm sorry, I keep using artist. Because the artist is all of it. The whole side of it.
But, so we back at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame?
You started it. You wanted to be starting something.
Back at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame?
But I don't know. The whole thing about X would go back to the trap beat thing. If that's what he wants to do, man, let him go. Like, you don't know what he... Don't put judgment on his records until they come out. All he did was ask for a trap beat, bro.
Alright, Mr. College sports are better than pros. College basketball, they run plays, and the pros, improvise. What'd you think of the national championship game last week, man?
I didn't even see it, bro.
I think your national champion, North Carolina, they shot like 36% for the whole game, man.
And they won?
They won. They won the championship. Defense. They shot, at one time, they were 3-for-23 from 3-point.
I guess defense wins championship.
Oh, there's the excuse there.
Well, how they won then? How
they
the fuck
they won? They shot 36%. You telling me... That sport is a better ran sport than the professional.
So what was the percentage of the other team?
I don't know. The winning team shot 36.
Yeah, but
so
just
because
the goal. See, that's where you. Whoa.
And then there's a whistle.
So
every
so
other
does
play.
The ball have to go in the net for it to be a good game?
Yes. And
why?
And we can't have a whistle.
So if that's the case, then the All-Star game is the greatest game on TV.
Well, we can't have a whistle from the referees. Every 30 seconds when the shot clock's running dead, there's a foul. They call a foul
hey,
on every play.
That's because they're out there
getting, there's a timeout.
They're out there grinding.
Yeah, they're
bro.
Out there grinding.
They're not sticking their hands up.
What about
and hoping that they don't make it?
What about Lonzo Ball's pop saying that UCLA didn't win it all because of the white guy?
Because the white boys, bro.
They must have never heard of Billy Hoyle.
Look, and I understand. I guess you can make. I get what he was trying to say. But it was an ignorant way of saying it, and at the same time, it's like, well, hold up. It takes more than just speed and agility to win a game, right? It takes everything. Like, every player has their own thing that makes them special, and it's a team sport at the same time. So he's saying that, that if his son was playing, they would have won. They, you know, they'd be national champions. Pretty
his
much
son
crazy.
Did play. His son was the top.
Yeah, but he
dog
got hurt
team.
Though, right? He was out that game.
Oh,
right?
I didn't.
That's
watch
why.
It.
No, that's why.
I think he. I think his I think his butt got hurt from the Kentucky guy shutting him down. I think that's what happened.
No, but I think he was out. Let me see. No, he was out that game, and that's why his daddy went out there and run his mouth.
Ran on the floor, fussed at the coach. See, it don't get any better in college, people. These youth parents, you think they're gonna knock it off once they get to college? They're gonna do the same shit, and then they're gonna try to sell you clothes and tell you that they want a deal from Nike for $1 billion and haven't even got drafted yet. Well, LeVar Ball's a fucking joke.
I don't agree with anything he says. Look, did not mention the injury after the Bruins. All right. Lonzo Ball did not mention the injury after the Bruins Sweet 16 loss.
Yeah, he didn't. Yeah, his butt was hurting, bro. He didn't mention the injury because his fucking feelings were hurting. His butt was hurting. Dude fucking.
He just basically said that white boys' feet are too slow. Bro. Yeah, well. That's what he was saying. He actually quoted that. White boys' feet are too slow. That's why we didn't win.
Yeah, we didn't win. White boys' feet are too slow. DeAndre, what's his name? DeAndre Fox or something. Made your son look like
but
a bitch.
But you know what he's saying right there.
But it ain't his fault.
But here's the deal. Wait, I gotta. What I'm saying. I get what he was saying. What he was trying to say. Is it relevant? Is it true? Is it accurate? No. That's no different than people going out there and say black people can't play quarterback. Because they're not smart enough, right? They don't have the head over their on their shoulders. That's what he's saying.
That's not right to say either, though.
No, it's not right. But I'm saying that's basically what he said. That's what he was trying to do. That's exactly what he was trying to do.
He's not the
problem.
It's
not in your genetics to be a basketball superstar.
Because I'm 5'7".
Ball player. Because you don't have the foot.
Shout out to Isaiah Thomas.
Yeah.
No, it's not his fault.
About Muggsy Bowles, bro.
Well, Isaiah Thomas is the man now. Me and him are the same height. But it's not his fault that he said that. It's ESPN's fault, bro. It's ESPN's fault. It's all these companies that give him the platform to talk his shit.
And if he was just a regular dad like that didn't play.
He is a regular dad that didn't play.
I thought he played.
He played college ball, averaged 2 points a game. 20 years later, he comes out and says he could have beat Jordan 1-on-1.
No way.
He said all that shit. He said he could beat Jordan, he could beat Barkley.
But he scored average.
He averaged 2 points a game at a shitty college in Washington.
That dude's delusional, bro.
He is, bro. That's why I don't know why they gave him the time of day.
Yeah, at that point, you're right. Like, they should just ignore him altogether.
I mean, he's funny, I guess.
I know that played college ball for small colleges.
Dude, we know a guy just like him. Me and you both know a guy that's just like him that talks that much shit about how good they'd be in anything or how good they were.
Oh, yeah. Man,
we ain't going to call out names.
I know a lot.
You know you are.
Yeah. Yeah. You know a lot of cats that talk a big game, bro. But that dude, he's just... and I can't believe he doesn't realize that he's fucking up.
Do you know what that's like? I'm going to give you an example. It's similar to you and me. We drop little mixtapes around here. To come out on fucking BET or MTV and say we'd roast them in a battle right now. We'd roast Eminem or Nas in a battle now.
You're crazy. You know? Like, that's sick. That's retarded. You're demented.
Sit down.
You're delusional.
Yeah, sit down.
I don't get... And they're looking for ratings.
But, to his credit, if I knew that could get me some pub and maybe some endorsements or whatnot...
I might
go out and say that.
Maybe. Like, yeah. You think he's trying to get him some more money?
Of course. He's got two sons under this one.
He's got two sons under this one.
He's trying to get the play
ball. So I guess he's going to be in the limelight until all his kids get drafted, right?
Yeah, it's going to be like the Currys, right?
He should be one of the commentators.
He should have a podcast like us.
Yeah. No.
The LeVar Ball podcast.
He should be a commentator on TNT. Right next to Charles Barkley.
I can't wait. Playoffs start next Saturday, bro. That's your real basketball. Playoffs start next Saturday.
Real basketball.
Who's your MVP, bro?
You know, how can you say that the March Madness...
NBA playoffs...
...is not a great thing, is not great? Like
I can say that because in 1988 and 89, when I was 7, 8 years old, my favorite sport was not the NFL... It was not college football. It was not the NBA. My favorite sport was college basketball. because they had actual teams that got in the tournament. These kids stayed in school.
Yeah.
They were actually building powerhouses. Yeah, the superstars they were building. It's kind of how college football is now. And these tournaments were great. March Madness. I remember I used to get old Christmas wrapping paper from my mom and post this shit on my wall and have my bracket filled out in my room. No one loved college basketball more than me as a kid.
You know what was funny?
And it's unwatchable now.
Yeah, you know, I'm going to take you back. Do you remember every year when back in that time when March Madness was big and Pizza Hut had a deal with March Madness with the NCAA and
shout out to the Pie Top.
When you would order some pizza from Pizza Hut, you got the basketball goal with the Nerf ball.
I do remember that.
And they would the commercial with the little boy in the kitchen, bro, shooting the shot and the buzzer beater with the Nerf ball.
Mama never got me no Pizza Hut though.
I used to love that commercial.
You mean, Mama?
But it was so, like you said, it was so much bigger back then than what it is now. Really,
dude, UNLV, bro, Duke, Kentucky.
It was a lot of hype. It was
Carolina, Syracuse, Georgetown, fucking UCLA used to have a good team.
The superstars stuck it out. They couldn't leave. Now they can just go.
Michigan, thank God, Indiana was always good.
Thank God, I guess they got to play at least 1 year. And then the 1 year is garbage. Like, look what Ben Simmons did.
Yeah,
just trying not to get hurt. I'm just trying not to get hurt. I'm trying to get drafted. So I'm not even playing.
They need to either pay the players in college.
They do.
Or just let them go from high school. I don't mind all the best players in high school going straight to the NBA. Just make the even back then when they were doing that, when LeBron went to the NBA, the college product wasn't that bad.
No.
But now these guys, they just fucking around. They going in there for their year and they getting out. And now these teams like Kentucky and Kansas and these big schools, big college basketball schools, they getting these kids in for 1 year and it's a fucking revolving door. It's like Mickey D, like working at McDonald's. You got 1 week you see one guy, and next week there's nobody else working there.
And you know, said it best, bro, when I was listening to Adrian Foster.
Arian Foster?
Arian I'm still caught in it. I'm still in shock that Peterson, Adrian Peterson's coming into Warriors.
Tuesday, baby. Who that?
I guess. All right, so when Arian Foster basically broke down his years at college and why and what he had to go through as a player, and you can't tell me, like, his way of saying that they deserve to get paid. Like, the hours that he put in as a student athlete. And I guess the college's way of saying it is, we giving you a free ride to school, so this is how you got to pay us back. So we can turn around and make millions of dollars off of you to pay for your $100,000 scholarship. You know, we're going to turn around and make millions of dollars off of you because you're a star running back. And as long as you score in touchdowns, we fill in seats. And he said, dude, he was so used to working, like never getting any sleep, working around the clock. You know, you practice, I think they practiced 3 times a day or 2 a days, whatever it was, in the weight room. Yeah. And then when all that was done, he had to study till after midnight and then get up in the morning. He said when there was like a 2-3 week break in between when the season was over before spring training and all that started or whatever. And he said like he didn't understand how other students couldn't pass. Like it was so easy for him to study. Like he felt like he had so much time on his hands because he was so used to living around the clock like that.
Well, this is what got me out of that interview was everything that you said is fine. Like, I wouldn't mind it being just you get a stipend and a scholarship is worth a lot. Let's be real. Like, a 4-year scholarship, like, I could never get one, so.
No, and you know what? It shouldn't be fucking, it shouldn't cost that much damn money to get an education,
college.
Bro.
But the thing that got me, that kind of irked me about that, is when he said that he tried to sign up for certain classes, but he couldn't because it conflicted with his football
schedule. Right, it's fucked up.
Like, yeah, that's what's messed up
about it. He couldn't be who
it.
He wanted to be, who he strived to be. He couldn't get the education that he wanted because,
so
nah,
you're gonna,
you can't
yeah,
do
you're
that
gonna give me a,
when, that class is when practice is going on.
If you're
going
to give someone, an athlete, a full ride to school, you should at least let him major in what he wants to major in and take the classes that he needs to take to become what he wants to be. Because, what is it, like 5, 10%? Less than that, maybe like 2 or 3% of college athletes play any kind of professional ball.
Yeah.
You know what? I'd like to have Slick in here to talk about that.
Reiterate see, that. Yeah. And actually, because, yeah, he lived it. He lived
yeah, I mean, we're sitting here talking shit. Like, you I'd like to get
Tulane,
somebody
in. I think that, from what I hear, Tulane is one of the hardest schools to go to, you know?
It's up there, bro.
So, yeah, that, we could do that. We can shout him out, bro. Yeah. Not that Slick.
Shout out to Slick.
But it just the way that the lifestyle, like, that comes with it at that age. And then what really get about college, we go into that about the fact that these dudes are broke, bro, and they can't feed themselves. They eating.
Well, we could go into.
That's a whole nother story.
We could go into a big issue, not just athletes, just college in general, and just young people in general, that they probably don't teach the right classes before these kids get to college for them to manage money. Like, how many classes did we take in high school? You mentioned this now on the podcast, but me and you talked about, a couple weeks ago.
I can bring that up. Go ahead and I'll say it
but
again.
But they need that. They need to start teaching classes of like personal finance, how credit works, how to effectively, you know, build your credit enough to buy a home, how to manage a savings account. All this stuff needs to be taught in school over geometry.
Right.
I mean, unless you become like an architect. I'm 35 years old. I haven't, maybe in pool. If you're playing pool, you may use subtle geometry to find out where the ball needs to hit to knock it in the pocket. But I haven't used geometry in my life.
No, not really. If you do use it, you don't even realize you're using it. And it's probably some basic geometry. Like if you're trying to just kind of troubleshoot some angles in your head. If you're building something or whatever you're doing, it's basic.
Well, tell us about your science teacher, bro. All
right. So, what we were getting
chemistry,
at.
Chemistry, yeah.
All right. So, what happened was, you know, the chemistry class was the same situation. Like, I got an A in chemistry, and it wasn't from chemistry. All right. So, what happened was when I got expelled when I was about 15, 16. You know, I had sophomore year. So I went to an expulsion school. Shout out to Nova Academy.
Nova!
Oh, that was it's a great. That was one of the best things that ever happened to me for my life, all right? But besides that, we had chemistry class. And there was two teachers at the school that taught high school. And both basically, like, one split social studies and science. How this went down. One split social studies and English.
Science and math should go together.
And then science and math were the other side of it. So, So it was my chemistry year. And he had to try to teach chemistry to a bunch of dropouts, pretty much. The students who obvious it's an expulsion school, so it's obviously people who could care less about education and have obviously never really strived to educate themselves at that time. That's the last thing they're worried about. So how can they pass chemistry? Well, he tried to teach us chemistry for like 2-3 weeks, and granted, he
wasn't
a good teacher. No, nobody was really getting it. And
I went to real high school and didn't take chemistry. So.
Yeah, and I tried. Like, I was, you know, but there was nobody. The problem was, is like, when you got a class of people who are uneducated on algebra 1, and you're trying to teach them chemistry, you know, like, and then there's no, like, when you around people who you can vibe off of, and you might get a problem that I don't get, and you can walk me through that, and then we can work our way through this together. Well, nobody can actually get it. And I guess I'm trying to speak for myself. Like, I may have had a chance if we all would have been able to kind of process it one at a time, but we couldn't. So He must either he went to the principal, the teacher, or he took it upon himself to be like, these dudes don't need chemistry. Like, let's be realistic. They're not going to be going to college for this. I don't see it coming. So what I can actually do is teach these guys the math that they need to survive in life. And the next thing you know, we walk into class thinking we're getting chemistry, and he slaps business math on our desk, you know, and civics and everything that we needed that was basic math and
societal knowledge.
Right, right. To make it through your everyday life. And that's the most important classes that we've ever taken in high school. You know, how to write a check. Like, I know how to write a check because of that. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I even strive that to my kids. And
how to balance a check in a
account. Not balancing the checkbook, but I let them know that I emphasize more in their math and their writing more than I do on their, you know, no offense to their teachers or anything, but I'll make them study their math and their writing more than almost anything. Yeah. Their social studies.
It's because you can't get Common Core either, so.
Well, maybe so. I have them, look, I fuck Common Core.
Common sense.
I'll have them, yeah, I teach them the common sense way. Like, I show them, yeah. I show them a common sense way to multiply by nines and common sense way to, all kinds of math shit, but they'll be in here telling them to do some other shit, and I throw it out the window. If they got a problem with it, they can call me.
So you're right.
My very educated mother just. What was that old thing with the nine planets? We don't have nine planets anymore.
No, it's eight now.
To my right? Very educated mother.
There's still a debate over whether Pluto's a planet.
Shout out to Pluto!
Yeah, I mean, Pluto's the Pluto real Nash, deal. Right? Hey, it might be 10 planets.
You ever see Pluto Nash, bro, with Eddie Murphy?
No.
Me either. But I heard it sucked.
When did that come out?
It was in the 90s, bro. Is that we was in school.
The weakest movies that he ever put out?
Yeah, it was kind of around the
when he
Nutty
was falling
Professor.
Off the map.
Well, no, it was around... Well, yeah, I guess when he started to fall off the map.
You got to think, Brent, at 98, 99, I think he put out Life with Martin Lawrence. That was a good movie.
We put my dog to sleep, man.
It's fucked up, man. Why are you going to...
We're probably putting everybody else to sleep, man.
No. Why? Because we're talking about...
Shout out to everybody.
...with Pluto Nash. You brought that up. I didn't bring that shit up.
Shout out to Eddie Murphy.
But I think that... At the end of the day, we all need to rethink about the way, you know, like what's valuable to us when it comes to education, bro. Because education is priceless. Like, that's one thing I wanted to put across. And you can't put a price on it. And the colleges think that, oh, since it is priceless, we can charge whatever we want for you to go there, and that's not fair, bro.
Even college though, bro, there's only so many classes that are worth taking in college. That I just, you know, I just came from college.
No.
There's only
unless
so
you
many...
become unless you planning on being a professor to teach that specific class that is a waste of time, that you're gonna turn around and teach other students when you're old enough to be a professor a bunch of waste of time courses.
Yeah, I'm taking management courses, and they got me taking quantitative statistics.
Like that shit, like chemistry, like shit like that, unless you're becoming a scientist or something that's going in that direction, it shouldn't be, you know, like it shouldn't be a demand, like what they call it. It shouldn't be a required course, is what I was
saying. Requisite, prerequisite.
Yeah, it shouldn't be something required. If you want to take it, it should be some type of elective.
Look, dude, I took online classes at Nunez. And I went straight from the fucking test on the computer to Google, bro, and Googled the test questions. And that's, I fucking got an A in biology.
Hey, no shit.
Yep. You ain't cheating, you ain't trying.
But that's... see, when you do that, though, even then, if you Google something, be honest with you,
oh,
it's
it could
a great
be wrong.
Way to edge it. But no, what I'm getting at, you're taking me in a different direction. What I'm saying is, it's a good way to process it. Like Google, I learn a lot from Google, and it seems like when I do read stuff, and because I'm engaged in trying to learn it, I process it better.
Sometimes So sometimes you get on Google and you get fake news.
Yeah.
It's all fake news.
Yeah, but shout out to Donald Trump for bombing Syria, right? I guess that's a whole nother story here.
Yeah, we bombed the jetway in Syria, and they were taking jets off from there, the same location, like 2 days later.
Wait. What? So you mean to tell me that they were taking, that they did they
dude, it's the desert, man. It doesn't take long to take planes off from the fucking desert.
He just wasted a bunch of bombs, is what you're telling me.
I guess so. I mean, I guess you could say that, yeah. Because they taking planes off from there like 2 days later. It's a fucking desert. When you bomb the desert, you could take off and land from the desert. It takes no time at all to fucking repave desert for jets to fly up and down.
Oh, okay. So he just bombed their airways, right? He didn't actually bomb.
He was bombing like runways and actual hangars and shit where there was
so
jets.
Where they can't move from one place to another. Basically,
dude, I don't know. I wasn't there.
I know I wasn't there either. But I know it was. I heard it was like 59 missiles or something.
Yeah. So
well, here's fireworks the catch to that. Like, and that's where you know you come into this fake news thing. Let's reiterate this story here. The whole chemical thing, right? Some people believe that it wasn't even real. Like that was some old shit. That was old footage that was put out there. Of you know. That there was an excuse to bomb. Now let me drop that and say that it isn't. This guy Assad, if he's an evil being and can care less about human life, his own people, blah blah blah. He knows Trump is an aggressive person, right? Is a combative personality. That let's put it there. What if he set America up for a trap? Like, what are you supposed to do? Because you can't win. All right, so you watch a video, you know, like you get briefed on a bunch of kids getting chemically gassed and watching them suffer on video. You know, like this is what happened to these people. What do you want to do, President? You know, we're going to bomb them. So they bombed them. And
allow me to introduce first.
Yeah. So they bombed first, right? But that's what they aside. Like these people, there's countries that want America in war. Like they want America to go to war. So by them, you know, you're setting up the trap. That's exactly what we wanted you to come bomb us, because now we got you sucked in. Now we got you engaged. Now you got to do what you got to do. Now you in. You know, and if you pull out now, then you're gonna look like a sucker. So Trump's ego is gonna get in the way. And what really needs to be looked at is the whole North Korean conflict, bro. Because like that's the scary thing right there.
Shout out to Hawkeye.
As soon as that goes off, then you got to worry about this World War III thing that everybody's worried about. You know, that's when you gotta worry.
I don't know,
because apparently China is not feeling North Korea, but they don't want America to do anything about it. Japan's not feeling North Korea, but they don't want America to bomb them because they're afraid that North Korea is gonna turn fuck around and bomb China, and then so if they attack North Korea, then China and Japan are going to turn on America.
I'm off the ready reserve list, so
stop. Yeah, well, yeah, good. Lucky you. And this is where I get it. Like, if you need to protect, I think, I hate to be the selfish type, but we need to worry about our borders more.
Uh-oh.
A little, you know what I mean? Like, America goes around bullying everything. Like, I feel
so
like
we Debo now?
Yeah, we Debo. I think there's a better answer.
Put that gun down.
There's got to be a better answer than going around just fucking wasting money on missiles and shit, bro.
Get knocked out like your old man used to.
Yeah. I just don't see that. Like
gun down, Syria.
We know where this is going.
Get knocked out like Iraq used to.
We're going to constantly be in a conflict with somebody, bro.
Dude, we've been in constant conflict, bro. Since Vietnam.
I know. Pretty it's never going to end. Like, and you always.
If it ain't actual war, it's fucking Cold War. And if it ain't fucking Cold War,
like, the only time that I can remember in my life that we was not necessarily, like, right on the cusp of going to war with somebody was in the 90s.
Hollywood,
like,
Bill.
After the Gulf War was
Shout out to Bill Clinton.
Up to 9/11.
I did not have sexual relations even, with that woman.
Even that little issue that they had, you know, the little bit of conflict that was going on during the Clinton administration, it was nothing compared to what it was before the Gulf War and after 9/11. Look, that's the only time I can remember.
Look, y'all.
That there was some downtime when it comes to that kind of stuff.
Ain't a motherfucking thing we could do about it.
No, so we it's just out get of my hands, bro.
We just get up in the morning.
We All just we keep going to work. Worry about grinding. Like,
we raise our kids. We love our wives. We raise our kids. We eat our food. We go to sleep. We take our shits. And just let, you know, pray for those that do it. You know,
yeah, we piss too. We that, do man. Piss.
Do we?
Yeah. Especially after drinking some beer.
Shout out to Michelob, man. If ISIS takes over fucking Anheuser-Busch or Michelob, then we'll start worrying. Nah, straight up.
Be honest with you.
There's nothing. All that stuff's just propaganda, bro. Like, if I could give advice to you or anybody, dude, I just wouldn't even watch the news.
I don't.
It's
really.
So bad now. It's so propagandized up now.
It's all there's nothing positive going on in the news.
You got a Republican in office. It's time for wartime.
Anytime there is any kind of positive stuff, it's always the last 3 minutes of the news. Like, after they showed everything negative in the world, they'll throw, like, some kid who beat cancer, you know, and wrote a story about it.
Shout out to little Billy. Here's little Billy. He beat, after 3 years of chemotherapy, his cancer has finally been removed.
Yeah.
And join us in the 10 o'clock hour where we observe Trump's plans of what he's going to do in North Korea.
Mm-hmm. Saying he had enough of
Kim Song Jong plans on sending nuclear weapons across the border to South Korea.
It's sad, bro. And I think they nitpick. I think other countries that don't like America are nitpicking with him, because they know they want. Like,
dude, they treat Trump.
They antagonize.
They treat Trump like I treat you on the podcast, because I'll ask you certain questions just to rile you up.
Just to rile somebody up, you know. And his ego, he can't help it. I don't give a fuck what they're trying to do. This is how, you know, like, dude, we did that so we get you excited.
Dude, he's the two.
I don't care.
He's the Tupac of presidents.
I guess. Ooh, you just offended a lot of people with that one.
He's the Tupac of presidents. Yeah. Nah, he ain't offending people.
Nah, I mean, the dude's.
He ain't gonna let nobody. The dude ain't gonna let nobody say nothing bad about him.
He's never had to answer to anybody, so.
Well, that's one thing. He's never had a job where he had to report to someone. Now he's got the ultimate job where he has to report to 40 million people.
Mm-hmm. So he don't know how to handle it. And then he's saying that he's giving it back to the people.
Shout out to the people.
We still need marijuana legalization.
Well, here we go again, bro. Yep. Matter of fact, I saw my sister today and she agrees with you. Agrees with us, yes.
Everybody agrees with me.
And she's a nurse.
And if you don't...
She actually tried to open the podcast before Daryl's podcast, so the last one where we had the pharmaceuticals talk about Jeff Sessions, which I don't even remember. It was one of them questions I asked you to rile you up. She said she couldn't open it, but now, Michelle, you can open it on YouTube and check us out.
Speaking of nurses and doctors, Brian, I know I told you, I mentioned, like, you realize how old you are when you pull your muscles in your back, bro.
Sciatica.
No, it was in the middle. All right, so here we go. I'll tell y'all a story. We'll crack the story. So all I did was get up out of bed. My son is a year and a half. So all I did, he's crying, grabbing me by the legs, asking me to pick him up. See, I guess fresh out of bed before your blood's flowing, your muscles are stretched. All I did was hunch over and pick him up and pulled all the muscles in between my shoulder blades. And I tell you, it didn't hurt then. Not at all. Like, it was just a regular muscle pull, but it was in that awkward spot where you use everything. But it was still manageable. And then after that, the next day, obviously, y'all know I coach softball. So I was actually coaching third base. And one of my girls hit a line drive square at my face. And all I can do was pull a Neo Matrix move to get out the way of the ball. Without thinking that, hey, dude, you already hurt. And that was it. And it pulled out. Pulled so bad, when I woke up the next morning, it hurt for me to breathe. It hurt to breathe. Every breath I took was painful, bro. So here we go. And this is what I got to say. It's shout out to my homie Domingo, the great chiropractor at Simply the Precise Family Chiropractic. Dude's a beast, bro. I've been better ever since I went to him. Like, it went from don't know when recovery's coming to a valid recovery, as long as I take care of myself in a matter of hours, bro.
With zero to 100 real quick.
I wouldn't say 100. Zero to 25. and then gradually going up to 50, 75. And I just got to be careful, man. I'm getting better. Definitely healing. I'm going to see my boy tomorrow, bro. He's supposed to, you know.
Shout out to chiropractors in general, man. I went to one a couple of years ago. I got in a car accident. I went seeing a chiropractor for about 3 months. And, dude, I used to feel so good leaving that place. I got everything but the happy ending. But even just on my back, dude, you used to feel so relieved when you leave the chiropractor, dude. Like, fuck pain meds, bro.
Well, I didn't really feel relieved when I first left, to be honest with you.
Maybe the first time I went, I was the same way. Whoa. But after treatment kept going on, dude... Dude, when the treatment kept going on, I used to look forward to it.
I think
I had lower back issues.
Because I was in pain at the time, and he was adjusting and doing all the rubbing and pushing. I felt like I just like I was still just injured. But about an hour after I got home, it's like, damn, I really feel relieved.
You're literally getting stretched out.
Like, I was weak, but I was relieved.
Shout out to Bitty Boy, man. Bitty Boy's in school for physical therapy.
Oh, yeah. Big Boy. Yeah. Bitty Boy.
Bitty Boy, man.
Well,
shout out to Renee, man. We found Renee the last couple weeks, man. Shout out to Renee. Dirty Rice, man.
We're supposed to be doing... We're supposed to be getting together and doing...
That's old Parish. Hip-hop history for all you young cats, man.
For Sheezy off the Heezy.
Shout out to BJ. Happy birthday. The big homie.
But, like you said, but just in general, the practice itself, because it's all natural. So, like you were talking about pain meds. Pain meds is quick relief. It's the instant gratification that comes with... You know, it's always any instant gratification is always going to come back to the original state, bro. But like, you gotta crawl before you walk. It's just like eating it, like eating vegetables and eating right.
Yeah, like I'm trying to do right now.
You don't actually know. You don't notice it immediately. It's not like you're gonna eat it. Oh, I feel great. I'm healthy now. It takes time. You know.
Dude, I haven't had fried food in about a week and a half.
Damn.
Trying to cut down, but we just haven't fried anything around the house. But I fucked up today. I had a salad in the fridge that my wife had got me yesterday. So I went and ate the salad today. And they had this donut stick.
Bro, I ain't paying $6 for a fucking salad. I'm just going to let you know. Listen to me, old cheapo.
Yeah, you ain't even told... I ain't even told you where the salad was from, bro. Why you snitching, bro?
But I don't know.
Could have been a nice homemade salad.
But I like to make my own salad. That's why I'm saying that.
Well, she does too. But she ordered pizza for the kids, and she knew I wasn't gonna mess with the pizza. So she ordered me a salad last night.
What about a thin crust?
I got a thin crust in the freezer right now.
A little slice of thin crust, bro.
I'm gonna heat up after we get done, bro.
Your bad.
Yeah, my bad.
You just talk about eating healthy and you're going backwards.
I'm
going
to eat it. That's not backwards, bro. It's just a little pizza. I think I heard.
Well, that's what I was telling you. Why didn't you get the thin crust last night?
First of all,
I think thin crust is the best tasting pizza.
I'm going to shoot out a diss, bro, to your old peeps. I haven't eaten Domino's since they changed the recipe. Since the first time they changed the recipe, bro. Shit's fucking garbage. And I don't care. I know you, you know, I know you, you hustled there for a few years back in the day. But Pizza Hut has got Domino's off top. And then when you go to Chicago, bro, and you eat the fucking pizza in Chicago, you don't want Domino's or Pizza Hut no more. You don't want any of these fast food Pizza Huts. So I told my wife the other day, shout out to Ben's. Ben's Pizza is probably the best pizza down here where I'm from. And so I didn't really want to deal with the pizza last night. So she said, well, let me get you a salad. But I worked 11 hours at work yesterday. When I got home, she's like, hey, I got you the salad. I had to get some protein in me. So I ended up eating leftover beef stew. Not that any of you people give a fuck about what I had for dinner last night. But Higgnz brought it up, so I thought I'd share it.
Well, first, bro, beef stew is actually good for you. Let's start there. What's wrong with
beef
stew?
Well, you got to go light on the rice, on the beef stew.
I don't,
light on the rice.
I'm not a big rice guy anyway. I used
always
to
always light on the rice.
But I do the same thing. Like, I'll sprinkle rice. I like eating the shit without rice, bro. And then, like, you take
well, I'll do red beans without rice. Because my wife, she cooked that shit up thick. I do and that thing's just like a gravy, bro. I just fucking just eat that shit without the rice.
I do it, too. I eat the red beans without the
so
rice.
So now, shout out to Fats. I seen Fats had a juicer, bro, with all these vegetable juices he's making. So he's making me jealous. Like, I'm not a big veggie eater at all. So I might end up getting me, like, a little juicer to where I could put some sweeter fruits in with the vegetables to help get that shit down. So holla at me and let me know if that shit's any good.
I got a question. I'm doing some blending, bro. Mixing, throwing some shit in a blender. What's the difference between a blender and a juicer?
Dog, I don't know.
That's the question.
I don't know. Fats, hit us up and let us know what the difference between a blender and a juicer
like, how does it, how does it, why is a juicer so much more expensive than just a, than a blender, than a basic blender?
Maybe a juicer, you could throw the whole fucking fruit in there. It'll chop the whole thing up for you.
I don't know if that's really good to just chop up stem and seed, bro.
Yeah, maybe so.
I don't know. We'll find out. I'm sure you can Google that question.
Hit us up if anybody knows that, bro. D by D Podcast on Facebook. Give us a follow. And then hit us up. Let us know.
Yep. Between YouTube and SoundCloud.
Yeah, you can
throw
anywhere.
A comment somewhere up in there. Even
yeah,
if
it'd be
you
nice
got
if,
shit
you know,
to talk.
We see we're getting a few listens, bro. Hit us up with a question or anything.
Well, I'm just ready for the new music to come out, bro. But can't rush excellence, dude.
Or you can't, you know, you get a lazy engineer, it takes him some time.
Yeah.
I got three kids running around here.
Nah,
it takes me a little time.
Nah, I think you're doing a mighty
fine
job.
I gave you a little preview.
I'm actually ready to get back in the studio, bro, and start recording again.
I think I'm close to you, doing the same thing. I think we're going to have some ideas. Hopefully we get a D-by-D thing going pretty shortly. And get your solo shit done.
The D-by-D record, yeah. Well, I'm working on one day at a time. It's going to happen. It one thing at a time. You can't rush it. Like, one thing that we really taking pride in is the value of the records rather than... I was always a quantity person rather than a quality person. And so everything... a lot of the music that I did over the years was raw, bro.
He said, fuck a dime, give me 5 twos.
Yeah, right. I guess that's always like that. But for me, in most of the... You know, like for real hip-hop heads, people that listen to hip-hop, rather than just looking for a jam, you know what I mean? Like, you don't listen to the beat necessarily first. You're looking for lyrics first. And so most people that listen to lyrics are always, they not even, they can care less about the quality. They just looking for the art in the lyricism.
Really, yeah, really got two types of music listeners in general.
Right. What you're trying to hear.
And I don't want to say it's male and female because it's not. Because they got some females that actually listen for content. But you got people to listen for the rhythm and the way the music itself makes you feel. It's really three types. Some people won't even care about the beat
right.
at all. Like, and they'll just go straight to content. But then you got some that kind of blends the two in. Like, they want to feel, they want to feel the actual music, and they want to feel your words blend in with the music to have it meet. Like, I've been rapping for 20 years. I couldn't tell you how many times I've heard people try to spit gangsta ass shit on a soft ass beat. Mm-hmm. Just because it's the beat they had. Mm-hmm. And they didn't really have the diversity to steer away from it. So they would come spit this gangsta ass shit on fucking the soft ass R&B or softer hip hop tracks. And those are the type of people that you know, only listen for beats or this one thing. So most people, I want to say, I'm kind of steering myself in circles here. There are some people out there that actually want the combo. The music and the lyrics have to fit together. I don't know if that makes sense to you.
No, it makes a whole lot of sense. It's painting a picture. Like, if the colors don't blend, then
I mean, I'm sure you've seen it too. You've been rapping longer than me. You've seen people do the same thing. Like, they would take certain beats. I guess I'm telling y'all a pet peeve right now because I've seen it. I've seen it a lot of times. Like, people would come in and try to spit certain shit to a beat that
doesn't fit the song,
doesn't fit the beat. It doesn't fit the music that's behind it.
Well, I mean, and that's either, it could be a variety of things. Like, it could be, you know, the fact that they're just experimenting. They don't really.
No, I think it's the fact that they don't experiment. They're only familiar with doing one type of music.
Oh, so you saying, they'll come in and they'll, what do you mean, like, drop, they'll have a love song style beat.
Say we had Feenan.
And go in there your hard, song Feenan? Yeah, and going in there hard, rapping gangster.
Yeah,
to
they'll
it.
Be in there rapping gangster.
That's just pure ignorance. Like, you couldn't find a better beat to fit that those lyrics.
Sometimes access is not an issue now, but when we were growing up, access used to be an issue. You know, nobody had beats. You'd have to go to fucking Tower Records. There was two ways to do it, your way and my way. Your way was, you'd have to go to Tower Records or Sonic or Sam Goody
and buy the singles with the instrumentals. Yep.
We used to do same thing Chris did. I wish Chris was here because I was going to bring this up with him here.
Well, shut up. Well, I guess
shout out to Chris Styles. Yeah. Chris did it a different way. You said he did it on a tape deck. We did it on a computer to where we would take the last, it's pretty much the same thing DJs do. We would take the last four, we'd take a 4-second sample of the track at the end of a song or the beginning of a song, and we'd loop it 30 times to make a 4-minute song.
Yeah. And what's so funny about that is, what we used to laugh about, and there's two sides of it, because we couldn't have access to any other tracks, so we had to, like, we improvised, like, you know, when there's a will, there's a way.
We'll make this work.
Rappers, we're gonna find some beats one way or another, and that's what
we'll say. And pat on the fucking.
But it wasn't nice popular to do that back in the day, like in the 90s. It wasn't popular to do that. But then when you get into the late 2000s, that was a big deal. Mixtapes. Everybody was hype on their mixtapes more than the albums. Like, the mixtape's so much better than the album. And everybody was just rapping over other people's beats when we were doing that long before that was even called a mixtape. You know what I'm saying? So it was so funny. We really laugh about it is because these dudes are doing mixtapes now. We were doing that shit long before it was even labeled a mixtape. That's how we made music. You know what I mean? And that was a big deal, bro.
Shout out to all the rappers. I think it started with them.
But yeah, those days, it was so, you know, like, I didn't have the skills I had now, like, because I grew and I, you know, it's just.
Oh, I go through some of my old records sometimes, and I'm like,
"What's so great is the muscle, bro. It's the muscle. The muscle, the brain is a muscle, and it's the strongest muscle you have in your body. And you develop that brain, that muscle. the brain, that muscle, you develop it, and you can watch yourself grow.
Well, I think,
and that's what's so great about music, let me finish, is that when you can go back and play the beginning of your, you know, your
catalog,
and as you carry
that's
through,
where I was going,
you
yeah.
can see the growth.
Yeah, that's where I was going. You can actually, that's the beauty of listening to your old shit.
Right.
It's like, man, I came, not like it sucks, but I go to my old shit and I'll be like, you know, that's cool, like, but listen how far I came from here yeah. until now. Now, I can't go as far back as you can because we lost a lot of shit.
Especially when you start at that young age, at a teen, just think about a teenager themselves, all right? A teenager is still trying to find themselves into society, where they fit in the society. Just like, you know, when you go through high school, that's where you get your cliques and you get your molds and people get into their, you know, they find something that they into and they gravitate towards that crowd of people. And it's the same thing when, and that's what the music tells. The music actually portrays that story. Because you kind of emulate what you're into when you're younger, and then as you grow as an artist, you find yourself, and that's when you actually create your own path. When you actually develop as an artist, you know, as you get better, you actually find and create your own path in life, just like we all do now. We all have our own path in life now, as opposed to when we were younger. You know, it was that you were trying to find your clique, trying to find your crew, trying to find your niche.
Well, that's anywhere in life, dude.
You could see it in music. I know, but music is a representation of that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, the older you get, the more independent thinking you become.
Exactly.
That's like your kids. Your kids aren't going to hear that right now. They're going to do whatever. We have kids. Actually, the cool thing about me and Higgnz, we actually have kids that are roughly the same ages, except I have boys and he has girls. And you can't tell him that, because I know you can't tell him that, because you couldn't tell us when we were 12 or 10 years old that we can't dress a certain way or do a certain, you know, act a certain way because our friends are doing it, you know. Like, our parents used to tell us, like, you know, be yourself. You don't worry about trying to fit in all the time.
Well, you know what's so funny about that is we'll get into that. Like you said, with the kids and how, you know, they dress different, act different. Like you kind of, this is how I kind of taught myself a lesson the other day, how you just kind of got to let them be. You know, I have a teenage daughter. My daughter's a teenager. She's actually, you know, like, she came home and she wrote a poem. And she read me the poem. And I'm like, wow, you know, this is actually, you might have, you know, you got what daddy's kind of good at. This is actually a good poem. Like, there's something, and I tried to explain to her poetry. And she didn't even understand the meaning behind the poem that she wrote, but I can see so much in it, and that's what I tried to tell her. Like, I could read this poem and I'm gonna get something out of it. I can turn this poem over and read it to your mother, and she's not gonna see the same thing that I see in it, because it's, and that's what's so beautiful about art. Like, she might find niches about it and it can stray her in a different direction than what I read it as. And I tried to explain that to her, and I guess maybe that was force feeding, but this is what's so funny about that is, we go back to Tupac. I'm like, this might be a good time to show her why Tupac is so special, because the week before that, her and her friend was telling me how much Tupac sucks. You know? So, well, like, well,
my son,
I'm gonna
hasn't
win
got that yet. Yeah.
I'm gonna prove my point right here. So I showed her some Tupac, you know, I didn't show her, hit him up. I showed him, like, Brenda's Got a Baby and Keep Your Head Up. And she just, like, wasn't feeling it at all, bro.
Aww.
Broke my heart. But then that's when you come to realize it's just because it's the sound. It's a different era. Maybe she wasn't mature enough for it yet. You know, or like, didn't understand it yet. I mean, it wasn't...
Just like when you was a kid, your mom couldn't play 60s music around you.
And that's what I come to realize. Like, they're going to get into what they're going to get into. But it's the message behind the music. I was trying to show her the message behind it. Right. Like, there's a deeper meaning behind what you hear. And, past the beat.
There's some young cats putting out messages, you know. You just kind of got to weed through the bullshit.
Speaking
to get to
through
it,
like... Did you hear new Big Sean song?
People been telling me to check him out. I've heard some of his stuff.
Last night I took a L, but tonight I bounced back, dude. This shit is tight, bro. It's hot, like it's been a long time since a new rap song had
got you amped up.
Yeah, like I could play this, I could fuck with this.
And shout out to Big Sean.
Yeah,
Big Sean, Chance the Rapper. Everybody's been telling me to listen to Chance the Rapper.
Yeah, I haven't checked him out yet.
Of course, you got J. Cole's new shit. And, J. Cole, I like all his music. It's just, I know he's not rapping to me.
No, he's not.
Not being white, just being just older
he's
cat.
Trying
he's
to,
a younger
he's
dude.
He's trying to appeal to people who are younger than him.
Yeah, yeah, because he's not much younger than us.
No. He's got to be at least 30 now.
But
And he's appealing to people who's younger than him. And he's, there's a lot of people who
they got this dude Joey Badass people to
tell
me to listen
to. He's feeding a lot of
to.
People.
They
so,
said Joey Badass is good. Oh, you might
Joey
never heard
Badass,
of him.
That's an old...
No, he's a new cat.
You sure?
Yeah, he's new.
Well, here we go.
Fairly new, you know. I don't know how. If he's, maybe
there's
four
a badass.
Years old.
There's
a badass from the LBC.
Yeah, maybe that's what I'm thinking of.
Yeah, but, he's all crazy with Tupac,
yeah,
Machiavelli.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking about. But it's hard to find. It's all about me is about substance, and what makes rap music is so special, is that it is preaching to the congregation with a beat,
dude,
is what it is. Now I'm not dumb. Let me, and that's what made that's why I like the Big Sean song. Like, it's the most. You go around and you go take all these. When you watch, let's say you watching a pregame, and you got all these cats with their Dre headphones on, warming up. Go ask them what they listening to, and I guarantee you the majority have rap music playing in their head. And it's the motivational aspect behind it. It's the inspirational aspect behind rap music that makes it so special.
I don't know. I was on the elliptical the other night, and I was bumping all classic rock.
No. Let's get it. Don't get it twisted now.
I was singing Deep Purple.
Rock music will push you to the BPMs in rock music. It is. But what I'm saying is that's the music that makes me, that's what makes me move, is the motivation behind the music, and that's what makes it special. But I feel that's what I'm worried about where rap music is going right now, is that it's losing that. You know what I'm saying? Like,
I think it's starting to make a little comeback. But what I was about to get to is, I think the reason why we haven't listened, well, at least my end, I haven't listened to a lot of these cats, and maybe I could blame it on the digitalization of music, is because it's so easy to find music now. It's not like I got to go to the store and buy a disc or even spend money on it anymore. I can just go to YouTube or Amazon Prime and listen to these cats whenever I need to.
Yeah.
Where if I had to go buy a Chance the Rapper CD, some guys I work with keep telling me, go check out this dude, Chance the Rapper. If I had to go to Best Buy or Sam Goody or Tower and buy the disc, I'm going to listen to it because I just spent $15 on this shit.
Yeah, right. I'm going to get my money's worth.
I'm going to check it out. And I think that has a lot to do with it, why we don't end up listening to these dudes. Because they're not actually coming out the same way that we're accustomed to.
Maybe. You got a good point there. You definitely got a good point. But I want to hear. But besides, you know where I search from? Like, I'm searching through the internet for music. Like, I feel like what I'm looking for in an artist is I'm trying to touch his, I'm trying to get as close to reality-based records as I can find. All right? And I like club records. I do. I like to have a good time. I like good club records.
Shout out to Poncho. He's waiting for us to do that.
But I spend a lot of time grinding. So what I want is music that is going to,
like, you want songs keep like motivate
me grinding. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's going to push me through the day and help me finish grinding. And that, or I want music that has a message behind. I want a good story. I want a good music, musical message. I want some inspiration. I want issues.
You
want
to learn something when you're done listening to the song.
That's what I look for. And it's hard just for like me when to you find read a book. That. But anything, see, and I feel like the mainstream agenda is a dumbed down agenda. So anytime there's a new mainstream artist, you've got to really prove something to me for me to listen to your record. And that's why I like the Big Sean record as much as I do, because what it is, it's a good pregame, it's a good get to ride, like ride to work record. You know what I'm saying? Like, right. I'm about to get on the ground. You know, I coach softball. Like, these girls are going to, like, they that's their thing. They like Big Sean. You know what I'm saying? So that's what they're going to want to hear.
Detroit.
If we lost the last game, and we're going to win the next one, if I get one of my moms, as soon as this game's over, you better press play on that song. It's going to inspire them. It's going to motivate them. It's going to put them to work. They're going to want to do that again. You know what I'm saying? And that's the music I look for. But what I'm getting at is the mainstream has such this big dumbed down agenda that anytime it just kind of shoots, like I stray away from it.
Right.
Like I'm not, you know, like this dude made it big time, and J. Cole is the biggest example for me. And J. Cole, straight cat, shout out, big shout out.
We open for him.
No hating. But what I'm saying is that, like, people sat down and said, you got to sell records this way. Like, his mixtape is that first, but warm-up mixtape is off the chain. It's real shit. And then when I heard his commercial records after that, I'm like, oh, come on, really? We got to go there. Like, why you had to do that, you know? No offense. But I was looking for warm-up. That's what I was looking for. I was looking for that.
Well, let me ask you this.
So I searched through the internet to find my music.
Well, like, let me ask you this. Like, all these young cats that I mentioned, and I'm guilty of this too. They're probably on the radio. But how often do we listen to the radio to really check and see what's on there? Because what else is on the radio is stuff that we're really not into. And I'm not hating. I don't even want to hate on them trap dudes. Like, I'm just not into it. It's just not my type of music.
It doesn't move me.
My son likes it.
It doesn't do nothing
so,
for me.
Yeah, right. My son likes it. He likes Panda. He likes that shit.
That's like, it's no different. Like, me trying to get my kid to listen to Tupac is no different than them trying to get me to hear, me to be into the trap song.
Let me get to my point here is, they're putting that music in with the music that maybe we should be listening to, and they blended it in on that one station. So because of the fact that we don't want to hear this one type of music, we may be missing out on the conscious music that we are looking for. And that could be hurting these artists too. Like, they may cannot break through to people that may listen to them more. It may not affect them because the same young kids that are listening to Panda may be listening to this conscious shit too. So they may not care that we're not getting into their music because we're not checking for the radio to hear dudes like Chance the Rapper, because he's getting put in the same rotation as Designer and Future.
Well, they appealing to their market. Like, these radio guys are smart. They know that me and you are actually what we're talking about. We're not listening to that anyway.
They're right, appealing right. Well, what I'm saying
to
is
an age demographic.
What I'm saying is there may be better music than we think is out there. We're just not, like, I'm telling you, Joey Badass. Like, people keep telling me about this cat.
Yeah.
We're not checking for him because he's not, well, he's not in the right pool. He's getting put in the pool with these other cats.
That's what I'm saying. Because, and he's getting put in there,
Now, Joey Badass might be whack, because I've never heard him yet. But a lot of people keep telling me to check him out. Yeah, they're like, dude, you got to check the Chance the Rapper. That's another one. You got to check this dude out. I'm like, I plan on getting to it, but for the fact that the easy access to the music where I can just go back and listen to stuff I'm used to, added to the fact that these dudes, I'm not listening to the radio because these dudes are drowned in the pool with stuff that I really don't fuck with.
You're not even willing to sit there and wait for Joey Badass's song to come on because you got to go through you got to go through all these other guys to get, you know, and hope that it comes on.
And add the fact that he has to give the music away.
Yeah, well,
more or less,
yeah. They got to get paid other ways, you know.
So I mean, that's a real struggle for cats like that, because he probably don't want to be lumped in with them dudes.
Does he or does he not? You don't know.
Well, you don't know what I mean.
You know, I think he does in a sense. And what makes him stand out is if he is that, like, you got to check him out. Well, he's original.
Well, next podcast, I will have a Joey Badass review for you guys.
You're going to check it out.
I'm going to check it out this week because I'm talking a lot about him. So I got to check the dude out.
There is so much. There is good new music out there, no doubt. It's out there, bro. It might not be like a full album of good music, like for our demographic. Let me just put that, you know, for what we're listening, what we're looking for. But the market is so saturated that it's hard to find it now. You know, how do you look for it?
That's like I always say, the easy way to make it. It's so easy to make music now, and it's so easy. The internet, for as good as it is, it's bad because of how...
Because it's so saturated, it's easy as it is. And usually the music that I find that I like new artists, that I stumble upon them through the internet. That's usually how I find artists. It's just by, you know, clicking on an artist and then... that I like, and then find, you know, it puts you in a link with similar artists that are relative to what you listen to. That's usually how I find new artists. But at the end of the day, I just think that it's hard for anyone to really get into and find that upcoming artist, like the hype. There's you know, like the anticipation for an album's not there no more, bro. So you can't find any love in a new artist.
Well, you could factor that in, the anticipation, to where how albums used to leak in the 2000s. Like, you can't promote a record like you used to. Like, Higgnz drops a record in July 4th. You know, the week before.
Shit.
The label's got some of that music leaked out to radios and stuff like that. Radios and DJs and stuff like that. And somebody's going to take that shit and leak it on the internet. So these guys can't do that no more.
Yep.
They kind of got to say, okay, it's April 9th. I want to put a record out on April 22nd. So I'm going to let y'all know April 16th that I'm putting out April 22nd. Yep. So by the time that shit gets around on the internet, I'm going to done put that record out, and you ain't going to be able to get it leaked.
And I wish I could go back in time, because I remember one of the most anticipated albums that I can ever remember was the Eminem Show, bro. Like, of that era. What I'm going back is the early 2000s.
Shout out to Saudi. That's where I was when that record dropped.
In about 2 or 3 days, like the weekend, you know, everything come out on a Tuesday.
Right.
The weekend before that album came out, heard it. You know what I'm saying?
Like, and you didn't realize the damage it was doing to the music industry when you did hear it.
No, and it probably came out the same way it did. Somebody had, you know, it was hacking going on back then, you know.
Oh, it was. That's after the Napster shit, man.
Yeah.
Like, the Napster shit had already blew up, and I think, what's the other company, LimeWire? I think LimeWire was out by then.
If they wasn't out then, it was out.
It was out not long after that. But they had done sued Napster. They done did all that shit after that, dude. So, I mean... I say that all the time. Like, that, the people stealing music, And I don't blame them because I've stolen
music too. Like you know, just want to hear.
You
this
didn't
shit.
Realize we were, you know, we were kids, but you didn't realize the damage it was doing at the time. If I could go back, I wouldn't do it. But you factor that in with the digitalization of music, like the just the making of the music. It's so easy. We're sitting in the living room of my house. If we wanted to, we could record a song right now that would sound almost studio quality, like. To an average ear, you wouldn't know the difference right. between our song and a song you hear on the radio. That's going on around the world. That's literally $600 you could spend on that. So anybody can do that now. And then you add that to the fact that people have to give it away because of that and the fact that people would steal it if you didn't give it away.
Your art's got to be in... You've got to find a new avenue. And you weren't
thinking of me a minute ago.
To... You've got to find another avenue to present your art. Like, how can you, you know, how can you express it? How can you get people to click on you? That's the whole key now. It ain't even about how CDs great it is. Or... About how can you get people to click on you?
Yeah. That's how you all can get people on your YouTube page.
It's not buying your record. It's just getting that click. How can you get the click?
Yeah, that's where the money. Money's in the mouse. The money's in the mouse. So... But we're going to go ahead and wrap this up, people, because we almost had like hour and 40, hour and 30 minutes.
That's all good. Hey, it is what it is, man. Look.
We get rambling about music, bro. We don't stop.
Yep. Just be ready. Be ready because the Soul Tribe is coming, bro.
Yep. So I am PJ. This is Higgnz. In case you didn't realize it, the whole hour and 40 minutes that we did this, we'll introduce ourselves at the end.
Yep. And we'll be back next weekend.
Yeah, probably on deployment again.
So. Yep, we'll get us. We're looking for the next guest, bro. They coming. So y'all take it easy. Have a good one. Have a blessed one. You got to make this universe a better place. That's how you wake up every day. How can you make this universe a better place?
Cheer, peace.